Welcome, everyone. My name is Alice Dillon. I'm the Associate Director at ArtsWorcester, and I'm here with Marjorie Rawle, Terrana Assistant Curator at the Fitchburg Art Museum. Welcome, Marjorie.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
As part of our call and response partnership with the Fitchburg Art Museum, FAM selects 10 works from ArtsWorcester's members exhibition to go on view in FAM's community gallery. Inside Voices prompted our artists to consider a wide range of interiors, including domestic environments, psychological subjectivities, bodies, architecture, and sculptural containment. These spaces reveal symbolic weight, mental and emotional states, fantasy worlds, gender roles, and personal memories. For this ninth call and response collaboration between ArtsWorcester and the museum, artists responded not only to the idea of interiority, but directly to one or more of 10 artworks on loan from the museum's permanent collection. Marjorie and I will announce these 10 selections now, beginning with Aaron Brodeur's Headspace.
I really loved Aaron's piece for its very commanding scale and materials, which is a really interesting transformation of those same aspects of the piece that was inspired by. It's a relatively small mask made out of, you know, natural woven materials. So Aaron's piece really turns that on its head and transforms those aspects of the piece. So I thought that was really awesome and really surprising. And it also makes visible this interior that the mask really can only suggest. So we can't really see the inside of the mask, but Aaron takes this interior and makes it visible to us through this, through his wire on the outside and the use of this kind of plush interior form. I thought that was a really interesting way to think about inside and outside and make both of them visible, which sort of the mask can't really do. It's really commanding and really very physical. Like, it's using a lot of materials that make you want to touch it, you know, the wood, the plastic, the plush, the wire, and it's making something like the title of the piece gives you a hint that it's about sort of the human mind. It's called Headspace. It's about this really intangible thing. And Aaron really makes it very tangible and very sort of in your face, which I think is a really exciting take on the mask that I was inspired by.
Elizabeth Buck's End of Day.
Yeah, so I loved Elizabeth's piece because when I selected the image of Augusta Savage working in her studio from the FAM permanent collection, I was really hoping to get some images of, you know, artists in their studios or considerations of the studio space itself as an inspiration for an artwork. And I just thought this piece felt so authentic and relatable right now in the way that it really captures the detail of this particular space of this artist. And I love the way that Elizabeth is linking the image of Augusta Savage as well as the image by Irving Wiles of the woman reflecting by herself. I thought that was a really interesting combination of both, you know, a physical interior space as well as a mental interior space. So I liked that she was bringing those two things together in this image. And I also like that, yes, it's got all of this great detail in her sort of workspace, but the really dynamic treatment of the watercolor on the ceiling and on the floor really brings it into this kind of dreamlike state. And then you sort of see the image of the figure slumped over, which kind of brings it back down to reality of kind of all of our present states that we can all relate to, I think, currently. So I just thought this was a really great take on those two FAM works.
Then we have Carrie Crane's While Reading Something About Matter.
I love this piece by Carrie because it's not so tied to the visual form of the piece it was inspired by. You know, Will Barnett's The Reader, it's not figurative. It really visually, if you were just looking at the two pieces, you'd say, I wonder how these two things are created or are related. And I love that when you read the title, Carrie is sort of herself becoming the reader. She's like putting herself in the shoes of this figure who's reading. And I love it because I'm imagining it as sort of like the logical next step or the next scene after Barnett's image. It's like the woman gets up, leaves the cat behind and creates something to process what she's just read, which is kind of what Carrie was doing. She's taking, subjects that she's been reading about in her personal life and transforming it into this, beautiful abstract piece. And of course, the craftsmanship is absolutely stunning. And so it's full of just tiny details, which I love. And I love that the way you're sort of surprised that those 3D elements are kind of just, you know, melting out of the surface. It's really an interesting take on this fan piece, which I really like.
Next, we have Jason Fearing's Four poster.
This is another sort of unconventional take on the fam work that I was inspired by. I also love the unconventional use of materials, you know, metals, canvas, sort of cheesecloth fabric materials. And the craftsmanship is just so precise that it really brings you into the very subtle details of this piece, like things you wouldn't normally pay attention to, like the edge of the cheesecloth kind of gauzy material. You know, I found myself really drawn in by that, which is so, it seems so simple, but the way that the piece is put together, those things become really impactful, I think. And it rewards really close looking, which is surprising given the simplicity of the materials, I think. And I also like that it made me go back to the Richfield image and sort of pay attention to an aspect of it that I think is easy to overlook, which is sort of the form of the bed itself. So it put me on another train of thought that I sort of wasn't considering when looking at this image from the fam collection. And I also just love that the artist pointed out that the subject of the photograph, of the Richfield photograph, David Joseph, made his living in metal trading. And that is just too much that the artist also works with metal. And so I thought that was a really fun, happy coincidence, as the artist puts it.
Claire Lima's The Place of Shifting Consciousness.
So I love that title. It sort of gets you into an interesting headspace, which I think is perfect for the piece that it's using. It sort of takes the subject of this reverie, inspired by the Irving Wiles painting from our collection, and it imagines like what the reverie itself might look like if it took physical form. You know, the painting shows a woman lost in reflection, but I think Claire's object seems to me like it's bringing what's happening inside of the woman's head to life and to form. And I love that the materials are completely non-traditional, which is awesome, juxtaposed with a very traditional sort of gilded frame and oil painting. And they really effectively, they're very different than the painting, but they really effectively tie back to the painting. You know, the shiny gold of the wire that she's using sort of recalls the gold frame of the painting, and the way she's dyed her wool pink really sort of points you back to that pink collar of the robe that the woman is wearing. And it's a piece that makes me want to just sort of look back and forth between the painting and Claire's sculpture sort of endlessly on loop. So I think that is a really exciting way to interpret that painting.
Next is Rebecca McGee Tuck's Visions of the Hereafter Now.
This piece is so engrossing in its sort of explosion of material. I absolutely love that about it. And I like the way it's drawing on several sources of inspiration. I think the connection to the Candida Hoffer image is really clear. And I love that the figure and the other decorative elements are really drawing on the sort of religiosity of that photograph, and the Italian Renaissance form of the piece is really cool. But it's also inspired by, you know, the moment and the theme of being inside and being, you know, stuck sort of in our interiors. But it's so interesting because she chooses this figure that is totally not of this time. It's sort of a religious figure, woman who's trapped inside of this kind of palace of found materials. So it feels both very removed from our time, but also rooted in our time, which is a very interesting combination and a really cool juxtaposition, I think.
Next up is Jane O'Hara's A Boy's Bullet.
Jane decided to sort of hone in on the violence in Edgerton's photograph. I think it's a really colorful, sort of dynamic photograph that I think the inherent danger in the image gets sort of lost a bit because it is so, you know, that blue is really shocking and that red is really sort of luscious. And I love that Jane's image of the boy holding a deer head brings that kind of danger and violence to the forefront and really makes it a more human narrative, which I think is a really interesting take on the sort of kind of still life aspect of Edgerton's photograph. So I think that's a really interesting combination. And I love that she's using the color palette of the photo really well. You know, you see the red of the apple in the boy's hat. And I also love that the boy's sort of really round face kind of recalls that form of the apple. And the blue, of course, of the background ties to Edgerton's blue background. But then she just really successfully tells a completely different story. You know, I also really like the detail of, you can see sort of the edge of a gun in the corner of her painting. And that's sort of just another aspect that you don't get to see in Edgerton's photograph. You see the bullet, but not sort of the device that the bullet is linked to. So I think she's doing these really interesting plays that make you think about the photograph in a totally different way, which I love.
Next is Kate Rasha's A Warm, Soft Whisper.
This piece is just stunning. I love that the extremely small scale really draws you in to an intimate moment, which is super important, I think, for this piece as it was inspired by you know, the loss of the artist's grandmother and a family home, and the memories and stories that these types of spaces can hold. The use of the mylar is really clever because it gives the space that hazy quality of our memories. So I think that was a really interesting and smart choice. And it makes it sort of less of a portrait of an interior and more of a portrait of the sort of personal meaning of this place for the artist. And I think that the emptiness is quite haunting, actually. And I think it made me look at the Candida Hoffer image in a new way for its sort of lack of figures. And it feels very empty. It's very distracting because it's so colorful. But seeing Kate's image and listing and the way that she listed that image, the Candida Hoffer, as an inspiration, I was sort of like, wow, this has a new sort of resonance that there's no one in this room. It's sort of this, you know, luxurious interior that is not filled at all. And so it kind of, I like the play between those two ideas that Kate is using here.
Next up is Ron Rosenstock's Looking Within.
Besides this being like an absolutely gorgeous and alluring photograph, I love this piece for the way that I think it combines ideas from so many of the different fam works that we chose for the show, and really hits the theme on the head, I think. I'm seeing, you know, the play between inside and outside that I can see in the Japanese woodblock print from our collection. I see the mind-bending sort of surrealism of the Carolyn Autry print from our collection. And of course, the formal link between the photo of the steel pipes that Ron himself named as his inspiration. So I think there's a lot packed into a seemingly simple image. You know, you can, a black and white straightforward image of a window, but then it's got this really awesome sort of mind-bending reflection. And I love that it's kind of hard to decipher. I think that's something that's really interesting about it. You know, we're not really sure what is making this reflection. And I think it captures both the physical aspect of interior spaces as well as the mental or psychological aspect of interiority really perfectly.
The 10th and final piece that is going back to FAM this year is Michelle Stevens' Now and Again.
I love this piece for the way that Michelle really zoomed in on the portrait aspect of Richfield's image, which I think can get lost in the original photograph because, one, it's so small, and two, there's so much pattern in the room that I think the kind of figure himself can be a little lost. And so I love that we get a really close-up portrait in Michelle's take on this piece. She used her really incredible draftsmanship to bring us, you know, into a much more intimate sort of encounter with a subject, which I think is really beautiful. And she's still sort of retaining that ghostly quality of the image, of the Richfield image, which I think is really a feat when you're using drawing rather than, you know, manipulated photography. And I also love that she makes that sort of masterfully subtle suggestion of the room space in Richfield's photo by drawing those delicate lines on her mat, which I think is really surprising and really the icing on the cake for this piece.
Thank you so much, Marjorie, for your time and thoughtful consideration, and congratulations to the 10 selected artists. These works will be on view at FAM later this year, alongside the original 10 works on loan from the museum's collection. Inside Voices, a members exhibition in partnership with the Fitchburg Art Museum, is on view now through Sunday, May 2nd. You can view all 100 works in the exhibition in our main galleries and on our website, artsworcester.org. Thanks for joining us.